Yes, a brief introduction, if I may, to the Insiders Outsiders project for those of you who may not be familiar with it. It was a brainchild, I have to say, of mine quite a long time ago now, some years ago, to pay tribute and to look in a much more nuanced and critical way than it hitherto been the case at the tremendously pervasive and extraordinary contribution made by refugees from fascism, from Nazi Europe to British culture across many different art forms. And it took the form initially of a face-to-face, year-long nationwide arts festival, which I have to say again, without wanting to blow my own trumpet in any way, vastly exceeded my expectations in terms of the warmth of its reception and the level of interest in what has proved, I think, Anna, you'll agree, an extraordinarily rich cultural terrain across many, many different fronts. Today's talk is obviously about architecture. Next week, we have something on photography. Those of you who are not familiar with the project, I would urge you to just Google insidersoutsidersfestival.org and you will get a sense of the range of offerings. There's a newsletter to sign up to as well. I'm just going to let in a whole lot of other people. As you can possibly hear, I'm slightly croaky. I've not been very well, so I'm going to keep my contribution very short and hand over to my colleague Anna Nyberg in a minute. But just a few housekeeping rules. You probably all know the ropes ad nauseam by now. But please do ensure that you remain mute. And you may also wish to turn your cameras off. The event is being recorded. It's up, it's your choice. And the recording will be uploaded onto the Insiders Outsiders YouTube channel, which I'll mention again at the very end. In terms of asking questions, I hope there will be a lively Q&A and interactive session after Nick Russell's talk. I would suggest that in the first instance, you type any questions or comments you may have into the chat function, which I'm sure again you're all familiar with. And we'll see how it goes. I will actually, can you please address them to me, to Monica Bohm-Duchin, so that Nick doesn't get distracted visually as he's talking. And I'll field the Q&A, and I think if appropriate, we'll ask you to unmute and ask the questions yourself and see. We'll see how things go. Very good. So without further ado, it's my very great pleasure to hand over to Dr. Anna Nyberg, who will introduce Nick and field the proceedings from now on. Anna, thanks ever so much.
Thank you, Monica. Thanks very much, and welcome to everybody. Well, it is literally a great pleasure to introduce Nick Russell because I count him as a colleague and a friend. He's also been my boss, interestingly, in the past. He's had a very, what should we say, a very diverse academic career. He's been in applied biology and looked at the history of science and technology. And he was also in the science the communication of science department at, or section rather, at Imperial College London, where our paths crossed for a second time. And he became head of department there, finally. And since he's retired, he's done all sorts of different things. He's volunteered in the heritage sector, which I suspect is really where this project comes from, his interest in architecture. But very interestingly, he also puts the Russell in Russell and Hobbs. And he wrote this account of his father's company, which is fantastic, not just on the technical side, but also on the kind of social and economic side as well. So that's good reading. This book, the subject of tonight's talk, I think is listed on the Insiders Outsiders website. You can buy it in the usual places. I shan't do any advertising, but it's very reasonable. It's only $9.99, and it's a cracking read. It really is. Covers so many areas, but I'm not going to spoil his talk now. And just to say, finally, he's also contributing a chapter to a book that's coming out next year on another emigre, an engineering company this time. So his interests are varied, and we all look forward now to hearing about Goldfinger and Lubetkin. Thank you. Over to you, Nick.
Thanks very much, Anna. Now what I need to do is to get the visuals up. So just give me a second while I see if I can sort this out. Right. I hope now that you've got a picture up on your screens.
Yes, we have.
We've already got something, yep, which is
Perfect.
my title sheet, Communism, Concrete and Council Housing, Lubetkin, Goldfinger and High-Rise Building. Okay, so there's a lot of words in that title. The three key ones are communism, concrete and council housing. What I'm going to talk about is the British council housing flood that happened after the Second World War, right through until the end of the 1960s. So kind of 25 years of intense council house building using concrete and concentrating on flats and apartments in slab and tall tower blocks. That doesn't mean that ordinary house building wasn't going on as well. A lot of council housing happened as well, made of brick and other traditional materials. But this was a big period of using concrete for mid and high rise slabs of flats. And the era came to an end really around 1970, when this particular way of doing things became deeply unpopular. Now, two of the people who were behind this movement to create high rise council housing were Berthold Lubetkin and Ernö Goldfinger. Lubetkin was an immigrant from Russia, and Goldfinger was a Polish-Hungarian. Strange mixture, but there's all sorts of funny things happened at the end of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, which meant that he wound up being a Pole, although he was ethnically a Hungarian. So they're both Jewish emigres. They came across to England in the 1930s, well before most of the, as it were, Nazi-induced migrations. They came over for economic reasons, but they are, of course, immigrant Jewish people. They were, too, also fairly virulent communists. So that's why that's the other name in the title. So Lubetkin, Goldfinger, and high-rise building. Okay, so let me now begin with the first picture. Let me have a slight problem. I'm going to sort of get it to move. Just a second. There we are. We've got something happening. Okay. This is a picture of a particularly important point in the history of high-rise concrete building in Britain. It's the collapse of Ronan Point in Canning Tower in 1968 in May. What happened was that there was a gas explosion in a kitchen on the 18th floor that blew out some of the panelling, and that led to this partial collapse. You can see where the 18th floor is because on the left-hand side, you can see the window is missing. It's been blown out. And then the other bits of the building corner there have got very badly damaged indeed. Four people were killed and 17 people were badly injured. And that really sort of made people realize that this problem they'd all been thinking about, this issue they'd all get worried about, was coming to a head. The problem was that these high-rise buildings were put up too quickly, and they were put up without being designed very well, and building regulations were not as sharp as they could have been. So a lot of bureaucratic reasons led to these blocks not being particularly satisfactory. They were also, for many people, they thought they were ugly. They didn't like exposed concrete, which is one of the features of most of these buildings. They've got concrete on the outside and it isn't very attractive, particularly not in British climate, which is cold and damp, and raw concrete doesn't really work very well under these circumstances. The best designers, of course, made a lot of effort to try and conceal that and make the outside of the building attractive, but throwing these towers up cheaply, and they were often ugly brutes, like indeed Ronan Point was a fairly ugly brute. And the reason why it collapsed was it was built on a Scandinavian prefabricated system. All the panels of which the building is made were constructed in a factory and then assembled on site. And that assembled on site, of course, had to be done with great care. If you get things wrong, then you will lead to structural instability, which is what happened here. And the problem was essentially lack of building control. People didn't really understand the system and therefore they couldn't really control it. The original Scandinavian system was only tested on buildings up to six stories high in Scandinavia. And then it was adopted on a much wider scale in Europe, going up to this 22 story block. So it wasn't a very satisfactory system. And this collapse really led people to think, this whole idea of building slabs and towers of concrete is not a good idea. So let's move to the next picture, if I can get the next picture up. Yeah. Back in the years after the Second World War, reinforced concrete seemed to be the answer to everybody's prayer. It's a relatively cheap material. It can be built into large buildings fairly quickly. It's not particularly cheap to do it, but it's quick, and you can do it very easily and quickly in terms of building and so on and so forth. When the thing started, the idea was to put as many of these concrete buildings together, multiple occupancy, tenement blocks fundamentally, And this is an example of quite a nice one. This is the Hume Crescents in Manchester. The model for this, believe it or not, is the Crescents in Bath, which the architect greatly admired, the Georgian Crescents in Bath. And these Hume Crescents were built on the same general plan. Not, of course, finished in Bath stone, but finished in raw concrete, therefore not quite so attractive. But this photograph, I guess, taken in the early 1950s, shows a perfectly nice development. Lots of open space. The concrete at the beginning here is not too bad. It's not beginning to wear badly yet. So the building and the estate is not too unpleasant a place to live. And indeed, many of these early estates in the early years, the first 10, 15 years of their life, before they had issues with maintenance, were quite nice places to live. The ones built later on in the 50s began to be more shoddy and therefore began to deteriorate faster. But the general rate of deterioration was not too bad until the 1960s. And then they did begin to deteriorate quite badly. And the more, as I said, the cheaper towers looked so ghastly, so people began to react very strongly against these buildings. And then we had another issue in 1979-1980, which was, of course, the rise of the Thatcher government and the right to buy scheme and the whole collapse of the public housing sector. The justification for it was, look, all these estates are falling apart. They're not very nice. We shouldn't live in this kind of place. And therefore we should abandon doing it, which we have virtually done for the last 40 to 45 years. That is, I think, to blame the wrong people. The reason why the estates got even worse in the 1970s and 80s was that there was a dereliction of the British industrial working classes. They could no longer afford to live anywhere, let alone in the council house. And many of them became impoverished. We have the rise of serious dysfunction, drug abuse, truancy, drug dealing, the whole panoply of social problems that go with poverty began to arise on a big scale. And on these high-rise estates, it's rather more obvious. Out on a more suburban estate of houses, it's not quite so clear that everything's falling apart. But on these estates, concentrated people, concentrated poverty, it looks pretty horrible. And the Hume estates, whoops, gone too far. Oh dear, I can't go backwards. Let me just try what I can do here. Why won't it go backwards for me? I will, yes, okay. Fortunately, I've discovered how to do it. Okay, so by late 1980s, here is the Hume Crescents, which have really got to the point of being the most revolting sort of place to live. They are new versions of Victorian slums. And this lot were indeed demolished, as were many others that were too hideous to contemplate. And the blame for all this inevitably was deflected away from the politicians, who didn't want to admit to the fact that this industrial destruction and poverty was a political act. They turned it onto the architects and the planners. It was their fault, especially as they were local authority people. Again, we're encountering this again now, the complete neglect of local authorities and the way they've been cursed and blamed for all the things that have gone wrong in central government. The same thing happened here. It wasn't the fault of the politicians, it was the fault of the architects and planners. And that was shown sort of iconically in one of the classic books of the mid-1970s, J.G. Ballard's High Rise. It was a novel about a severely dysfunctional high-rise building. It had this 40-story block built in the city. It wasn't actually a council property. He had it as a very sort of upmarket place. It was full of middle-class professionals. And the architect who designed the building was living on the top floor. And the novel is about really that the building destroys the people. It's the building itself which leads to the demise of the people living in it. They all go mad. And that reflected people's feeling about this high-rise concrete housing, particularly the council housing. This was what was driving people mad. This was why there was dysfunction and problems, rather than the more political reasons for it. So the high-rise area issue got very unpopular. Ballard's popular book, it was an extremely well-read and widely read book. He was tapping into this notion it was the buildings that were responsible. And then, of course, subsequently, things have got worse because some of these buildings, towers, survived. And as they survived through into the 20th century, and they needed maintenance and repair. And one of the things that was often done to them was they were clad on the outside with insulating material to improve their heat thermal efficiency. And that insulating material was obviously often highly coloured and made these towers look kind of postmodern rather than modernist. So there was a tendency to clad all these towers with this insulating material. But of course, that too turned out to be a disaster because we, as we only know too well, in 2017, the Grenfell Tower caught fire. This is a rather obscure picture of dawn following the fire. This is the building is in front of us. And what we're seeing at the edge of the picture on the left-hand edge is the edge of the building showing the, you can see it happening, the charred cladding is coming away from the edge of the building. The concrete frame is remaining fully intact, but the cladding has caught fire, the charring are coming away, and it was an absolute disaster, as we all well know. Again, is that a problem intrinsic to the nature of building these tower blocks? And the answer is no, it's a problem because of the failure to refurbish it properly. As the first lot of housing wasn't really maintained properly, so the ongoing maintenance issues meant that this lot weren't maintained properly either. Building regulation wasn't good enough, the wrong materials were used, and we have this disaster, which the report, I believe, has been, or the inquiry now has been going on for 2 or 3 years and will go on for a couple of years further. But that's another nail in the coffin of council house tower blocks. Another one went up in flames in 2017. So the appalling reputation of these towers is unfairly reinforced. But just as I'll argue, it wasn't the buildings, Ballard's thesis was wrong. If we now look at what the trendy and young people are doing at the moment, here is the middle of Manchester with a whole series of massive tower blocks going up in which young professionals will now live at leisure. And so there's nothing wrong, as it were, with the idea of a tower block, nothing wrong with the magnificent views and the clean air and so on and so forth that you get in a tower block. The problem lies, I would argue, always in the fact that they were not properly planned, not properly built, and not properly serviced. We're having them again now. And indeed, some of the ones originally built in the 60s and 70s, the first generation of these towers, the concrete ones, as opposed to these latest glass and steel ones, the best examples of them have survived very well. The classic example is the Barbican Estate in London, which is not, of course, a council estate. It's built, was built originally for middle-class people to rent who were working in the city, and it survived pretty well. It's three huge tower blocks, which are visually interesting. They're not sort of boring slab towers. And the middle-rise towers are also quite interesting, with very interesting hemispherical ceilings on the top of them. Lots and lots of open space underneath it, carefully landscaped, and then the entire place entirely free of traffic because all the cars, etc., have been taken underneath the whole estate. So the Barbican Estate is sort of, to my mind, a good example of what a brutalist concrete-constructed estate could be like. The only problem with it, of course, they were very expensive to build and they're very expensive to maintain. And that's, of course, the problem with all trying to make housing cheap. It's very hard to make it cheap. The result is always going to be decay, either fast or slow. But there was Barbican, and it's surviving now. I used to live on the sort of near it, very close to it, go to it frequently. It was a very nice place to visit. And even the old tower blocks, in the old council tower blocks, are being rethought and being revisited. Of my two protagonists, Goldfinger and Lubetkin, Goldfinger was the most notorious because he built the most dramatically ugly, some people think, tower blocks. And one of the first one he built was the so-called Balfron Tower on the Brownfield Estate out in Tower Hamlets. And this is a picture of it taken last year. The block, the tower itself, is not quite as it should have been. It's been refurbished, and 20th century enthusiast architects and fanciers will tell you it's been done wrong. It's been done with anodized aluminium and not with white painted woodwork, and so it doesn't really reflect the building as it originally was. But the point, from my point of view, is that it was elaborately refurbished during the 2010s, and it's become a very desirable place to live. The development was done by a housing association. They took over the whole estate from Tower Hamlets Council, They're going to retain the rest of the estate as rented council-type property, social housing, but they decided to redevelop Belfront Tower, turn it into saleable flats, and flog them off at good prices and use the capital acquired to redevelop the rest of the estate. And so that is the one bit of it, that's the tower block, is the one bit that's for sale and is desirable. It's the less, the more conventional buildings which are not so saleable and therefore would retain for social use. So there we have it. There's Belfront Tower with the sales thing just outside. That was taken last year. And I understand that they're selling well, the prices are high, and there are lots of people who want these flats in Belfront Tower, an old, decaying, apparently, council block brought back to life without too much trouble. Well, let's go on to my protagonists. This is Ernö Goldfinger standing in front of Belfront Tower. So this was shot probably in the late 1960s. Now, Goldfinger is, as I said, a Hungarian Pole, and he was born in 1902 and he died in 1987. Jewish family, very wealthy, Hungarian, as I say, ethnically, family owned quite large estates. They were big in forestry and were extremely well off. He thought just after the First World War that he would like to become an architect, and his family were able to send him over to Paris to the École des Beaux-Arts to get the best kind of architectural training he could get. So he trained there in Paris between 1922 and 1932. 10 years? Yes, it took him 10 years. It should only have taken him six, but for a whole variety of reasons, he spent 10 years as a student in Paris. We won't go into too much of that. But the one thing he did encounter in Paris, semi-formally, was that he worked in the studio of Auguste Perret, a French architect who had been a leading pioneer of reinforced concrete in the early part of the 20th century. And some of the Beaux-Arts students went across to Perret and worked in his design studio and learned a great deal about reinforced concrete. And indeed, Goldfinger put his Beaux-Arts diploma, set it in the Perret studio. And because it was so modernist and the Beaux-Arts were so old-fashioned, that's one of the reasons it took him so long to graduate, because they wouldn't accept his project until 1932, rather late in the day, but he was then accepted and could graduate. So he encountered Perret in that period in Paris, and then he came across to England fairly quickly in the 1930s. He was in England from 1934 onwards, because in Paris he had met a young English art student, and they struck sparks, and they came back to England and were married. Ursula Goldfinger, his wife, was extremely wealthy, and they decided that they would live in England rather than France. They'd prefer to live in France. But she had a big trust fund, but she couldn't get anything out of it in France. The trustees wouldn't allow them to take it out and do anything within France. They had to come back to England. So that's why Goldfinger had his career in England rather than in France. And he arrived here in 1934 and started to try and practice as an architect, not particularly successfully, as we shall see. He was a very slow starter. And in fact, his main achievements, Belfront Tower and Trellick Tower, were not really done until he was pretty well retired. So he was a bit of a tortoise, very, very slow to get moving, and we'll trace some of the things that happened to him as we go through, which was in a big contrast with the other man we're going to talk about, Berthold Lubetkin, who is here at the front in the paler suit with a team of people behind him who are members of his architectural practice, Tecton. And Lubetkin, too, trained in Paris. His dates are 1901 to 1990. He was a Russian. A communist, a bit like Goldfinger. They were both convinced communists. He'd been in Moscow during the uprising in 1917, so he had first-hand experience of the Bolshevik Revolution. And he remained a communist all his life, although he didn't much care for the bureaucratic version of communism that developed in Russia. He left Russia in the sort of mid-1920s, and never went back. He couldn't stand communism in practice, although he quite liked communism in theory. So he came to England in 1931. Ostensibly, he had an architectural project, but that collapsed. But he did meet a bunch of young British architects who had trained at the Architectural Association and were very keen on this new modernist stuff that was happening in Europe, Bauhaus, Le Corbusier, and so on and so forth. And they met Lubetkin, and Lubetkin had already done this modernist training. He'd been in Paris with Perret, had been in that same studio as Goldfinger had been in, and he'd gone on to build a block of modernist flats in Paris. So he was actually a man who'd done something, and these six young men were quite keen to team up with him to see if they could do the same kind of thing in England, do socially worthwhile building. They were all of them socialists, if they weren't communists. I think Lubetkin was the only fully paid up communist. Of the two women in the picture, one of them is the admin person at Tecton, and the other one is a young woman who's arrived as an intern in the studio, and she will eventually become Lubetkin's wife. That's the way things go. So this is this the first Tecton practice, which actually from 1932 onwards, despite the fact it's a very difficult start, works very well and quickly and establishes itself and becomes quite famous, whereas poor old Goldfinger is still not getting anywhere with his practice in the 1930s, but Lubetkin with his six British colleagues strides ahead with the Tecton practice. The two of them, Lubetkin and Goldfinger, had met in Perret's studio in Paris, and they took an instant dislike to each other. That dislike persisted for the rest of their lives. They couldn't stand each other. And they both, in their own ways, were rather deeply unpleasant people. Nobody really liked them very much, unfortunately, although they both could be utterly charming if they needed to be, but underneath it all, they were difficult and tortured individuals. Again, I haven't got time to go into that story. It's very fascinating, but we're going to stick with the architecture today. So here is Lubetkin. He's in London. He's done one building in Paris. He's got this small firm around him, and they're looking for work. But of course, it's 1930s, the Depression. Can they find any? No, they can't. But fortunately, one of his young colleagues in Tecton is good friends with the big people at London Zoo. And Lubetkin learns that they've just taken delivery of two gorillas, which they're very keen to house somewhere. They've got nowhere suitable to house these gorillas. And they've also got a very dilapidated way of displaying penguins. And so it occurred to Lubetkin, quite astonishingly, why don't we do some fancy animal house building? Why don't we build a gorilla house? Why don't we build a penguin pond? And we'll apply all our modernist thinking to these animal houses. And the zoo liked the idea, and they were commissioned to indeed design and build a gorilla house and design and build a penguin pond. And they did it with modernist principles, using reinforced concrete, pure geometry, austerity, the usual things we associate with modernism, and also in white painted concrete. The theme of the time was to paint them all white, which had been something Le Corbusier had been doing extensively. And that white effect, as we shall see, is something that Lubetkin ran with in some of his buildings. But that white finish was something Goldfinger hated. He called it Casbah architecture, and he would never build with a white finish. He always insisted on building with a concrete finish in raw concrete or using facing materials like tile and brick. So here's Tecton then. The first work they do is designing buildings in the zoo. Now, I haven't got a picture of the gorilla house, which is a little bit tedious, but we have got, of course, a picture of the fabulous penguin pond, which I think virtually everybody knows about, because most people who were children from the 1930s onwards were taken to London Zoo and saw this fantastic penguin pond. A display area for penguins with this incredible double helix penguin walkway across the middle of their pond. And then this austere white surrounding of concrete. The pool itself, the pond itself, has a blue bottom to make it feel like the Atlantic Ocean. And the Tecton partners and Lubetkin did some quite hard work investigating the lifestyle of penguins, and indeed they did with gorillas. They didn't want to make their houses sort of perfect environments for either gorillas or penguins, because Lubetkin particularly was keen on the idea that zoos are displaying animals. So the animals must display themselves. They can't be completely in an ecological environment. Because if they are, as everybody knows who's been to places like Whipsnade, they spend most of their time hiding. And that wasn't what Lubetkin thought a zoo should be about. So to display the animals, the way in which they were housed was a combination of thinking about how they would live in the wild, but also how they should be displayed. And here is this fantastic double helix display. And it was actually quite an important, I think, thing for popularising the idea of modernist and modernist construction in Britain. Britain is notoriously very slow to catch on to events in Europe, the modernist movement, modern painting, modern art, modern everything. The whole modernist movement was slow in England. But I think the Penguin Pond did a great deal to show people the tremendous opportunities that came from this material and using this technique of austere modernism with its geometrical proportion. Now, building these walkways was a pretty difficult thing to do. They're sort of more or less self-supporting, and they have to take the weight of keepers as well as penguins. So it's a pretty difficult engineering task to build these things. And it was quite beyond Lubetkin. Of course, Lubetkin was designing in concrete. He knew a lot about it, but he wasn't able to engineer something like this. He had to collaborate with a structural engineer, and the one that Goldfinger and Lubetkin met in the 1930s was Ove Arup, a Danish structural engineer who originally worked in Paris, but then came across to England. And he was the structural engineer who worked with both these architects and solved the problems that they had in assembling these very odd shapes and making them stand up. If we look, for instance, at the construction of that central set of walkways, here we can see the elaborate shuttering to create the curves and the slopes, and the extremely elaborate way in which the reinforcing concrete, reinforced iron bars, steel bars, have to be set up within this concrete, which is going to be poured over them, in order to get the right kind of strength. And if these bars are in the wrong place, then there will the structural integrity, the great strength of this concrete will not be there. You have to make the steels, put them in the right place and lay them correctly, which requires actually some quite elaborate engineering calculations, quite beyond architects, but some of the more better engineering, structural engineering practices working with architects had the mathematical engineers who could work out how to distribute these steels to make these walkways completely stable. So that was the first work that the Lubetkin's Tecton did. They worked with animals. But that, of course, was not what they were after. What they wanted to do was to build for people. And particularly, they wanted to build, as communists and left-wingers, they wanted to build for working people. They wanted to try and alleviate the dreadful housing issues, which were a hangover from the decay of the Victorian terracing in this country. We had a huge, essentially, slum problem from the early 20th century onwards, and hadn't been solved by the 1930s. Many working people were still living in appalling conditions. And Lubetkin is famous for a particular phrase, nothing is too good for working people. He was committed to the idea that ordinary people should have good housing. They shouldn't live in slums. They shouldn't be disadvantaged in their housing compared to middle-class people. Everybody deserved to have a decent place to live. A theoretical view from socialism and communism, difficult, of course, to actually make it work. But the thinking was we must build houses for workers. And in England in the early stages, council housing was still not really taking off very much in the 1930s. And so they couldn't find a commission to build any council housing. But what they did find was a commission to build some workers' flats for the person who ran the Gestetner duplicating company, a very big office equipment firm at the time. And the son of the founder, the younger Gestetner, became very close friends with Lubetkin, and Lubetkin agreed to build some workers' housing for Gestetner. And what he came up with was something which we now know as High Point One. A 64 apartment block of flats, 7 or 8 stories high, built of the reinforced concrete, white painted in the traditional technique of the 1930s. Lots of balconies, lots of light, lots of space. The trouble was that it was too expensive for Gestetner's workers. They couldn't afford to live there. The Gestetner had insisted that the building produce the same kind of returns on investment that a commercial building would produce. And Lubetkin couldn't get the price down to make it cheap enough for the workers. On the other hand, he did cut corners in such a way that it wasn't particularly good building. And in fact, High Point One has been a maintenance nightmare for quite a long time. It's still there. It's still privately owned now rather than privately rented. And I think the maintenance is sort of, they've got a handle on it now, but it's been an extremely expensive building to maintain. But on the other hand, it looks like an iconic modernist block of flats. And in fact, Le Corbusier, the great master of modernist domestic house building, came across from Paris to admire this. And Lubetkin was extremely flattered to know that the master had come and appreciated his high point one. Well, there was a piece of social housing, it had failed. The Gestetner's managers moved into it rather than Gestetner's workers. And also, Lubetkin was beginning to show a characteristic which made the other modernists around him somewhat worried. He began to do some strange things. At the entrance to High Point One, there are a pair of carefully sculpted caryatodes, Greek ladies who are columns disguised as women. Astonishing throwback to ancient times, and apparently completely incongruous inside this austere geometric building. But Lubetkin argued that the outside of these buildings was rather austere, and that people needed to be welcomed to their homes in some way. They needed to feel the building was welcoming. And this is one of the reasons he did this, was to try and make this entrance area a sort of nice, welcoming, sort of funny. The funny thing about it was this odd thing that people would appreciate. And he also said he wanted to reflect back on the history of architecture. He wanted to show that, in a way, modernism dates right back to classical Greek architecture. But already his colleagues were beginning to say, this looks a bit odd. This chap is doing something rather strange. And as we shall see, as his career developed, he became essentially a postmodernist before there were postmodernists. He was disguising his modernist structures very carefully behind decoration, which would have been living death for most modernists. But he was already showing signs of this way back in 1934-35 with these strange caryatids in High Point One. Now, Gestetner then bought the house next door and demolished that and asked Lubetkin to build High Point Two, another development of block of flats. But this time there was no idea that it's going to be for workers. This was going to be for middle-class professionals, a beautifully built block, which still survives today as High Point Two. 12 luxury apartments. The one at the top, the penthouse, is the one that Lubetkin himself chose to live in for about 10 years. And you'll notice that the facing is now no longer raw concrete. There's some raw concrete about, and some white painted, but there's a lot of tile and brickwork has gone in now. The facing is now no longer so much concrete. And the reason for this is partly Lubetkin wanting to make his buildings more friendly to the people who are going to live in them, but also the discovery that thin concrete is actually a pretty disastrous facing material. You have to be very careful making concrete facing. If you've got your concrete deep in the building, it's not going to get wet, so there's going to be no problems with rusting concrete steels. But if you put concrete on the surface and you make it too thin, particularly in the British climate, rain will get into it, acid will eat it out, and it will start to decay and the steels will start to rust. So thin concrete, particularly as a facing material, is a disaster. But the modernists only really discovered that by doing it in the early 1930s, which is why quite a lot of early modernist buildings have been a nightmare to maintain because of this facing with cheap concrete, thin concrete. They were tempted to use it because concrete's so strong that you can make it very thin and still strong, but it has very poor thermal qualities, very poor sound insertion qualities. So it's a terrible surface material. So already, Tecton is abandoning it and beginning to put surfaces of brick and tile, which are much more hard wearing. They're still using flat roofs, which Ove Arup said was silly. He couldn't understand why the modernists had flat roofs. He said, you're going to get leakage, which of course they always do. All flat roofs always leak in the long term. He said, you should have put a pitch onto them. He said, you're only putting flat roofs on as a kind of purist interpretation of your modernist ideas. If you'd only put pitched roofs on, your buildings would last a lot longer. Eventually, people learned that, of course, but at the time, the flat roof remained something pretty central. But anyway, Lubetkin in the 1930s then has tried social housing and failed because he can't build it cheaply enough. He's trying to build some council housing. He's trying to attract people to commission him, Tecton, to build council housing. And he's having some success with London's poorest borough, Finsbury, which has become a socialist Labour voting local authority with a large number of communists also, or a small number of communists among the councillors. And they are very keen to do some redevelopment and massive public building. but they haven't got themselves together by the time of the war, and so they can't really do much before war breaks out. But somebody else, an English architect, does get much further with this business of building social housing, and that is Maxwell Fry. Together with Elizabeth Denby, a social an activist, they build a series of structures in concrete, white concrete. This is Sassoon House, and they also build a more elaborate structure, which is Kensal House, which has a school and a playground, allotments, a social club, and so on and so forth. It's all beautifully done. Again, it's not council property, but it's built for one of the suppliers of gas to London, and they had a bit of redundant land, and they said they were going to build this for their workers. It wasn't actually just for their workers. It was available on the open market, but they were very cheap flats that working people could afford. So Fry and Denby got ahead of the other two who hadn't even got started yet on social housing. The only bit of kind of social stuff that Tecton did before the war was the Finsbury Health Centre. We said that Finsbury was a place they wanted to do a lot of building in. Finsbury put together a health centre. A number of local authorities were doing this. They were a new idea. You would combine a doctor's surgery with a public health centre, and they were kind of models for what the NHS was going to be after the war. And this was the one that was put up in Finsbury, around which the council was going to build a huge new massive council estate system. It didn't manage to do that, unfortunately, because the war broke out. We won't go talk about that. So what was Goldfinger doing during this 1930s period when Lubetkin was motoring ahead? Well, the answer was not very much. But he did build his own house. He built a short terrace of housing in Hampstead called Willow Road, numbers 1 to 3 Willow Road, and he lived in number 2, which was the house in the middle here. And he was not keen on white finish, therefore he finished it in stock bricks, in London brick. He was told to do that anyway by the planners. They didn't want anything white in concrete. So his house is in brick. The modernism is given away by the geometric forms, by the use of these pilotti or columns at the front here in front of the house supporting the ground floor, and by this vast, great massive window that stretches across all three of the apartments, or three of the houses rather, and makes it look as if it's one single grand house. This was a trick he'd learned from John Wood in Bath and various other places. John Wood had put terraces of townhouses up and made them look like single palaces by making the centre look like a palace entrance. And in a way, Goldfinger is copying that same idea. Now, I'm conscious that time is running on, so we mustn't spend too much time here. During the war, neither Lubetkin nor Goldfinger could work. Both of them were, in a sense, aliens, and they found themselves very hard to get work. And in any way, civilian building came to an end during the war. Lubetkin actually went out to the Cotswolds and started farming and became a part-time architect during the war and afterwards. Goldfinger couldn't get any work at all, so had to spend time writing about architecture and developing his own ideas about modern architecture and modern building. He was very successful at publishing this, and that's why many young modernists admired Goldfinger, because he, as it were, written the textbook of modernism for British people, or for English architects during the war. And this is just an example of some of his wartime work. This is the Goldfinger's version, public version, popular version, of the plan for London, the Greater London Plan, which was put together Abercrombie. I was having a senior moment there. Abercrombie's plans for central London. And this is Goldfinger demonstrating in a popular piece of infographics that if you have a requirement for a certain density of housing, if you put everybody in terrace housing, then you'll have very little spare land. And if you put them in bigger and bigger apartments until eventually you get to big blocks at the bottom, you can liberate a lot more land for parking, for making parks rather than car parking, and for access and infrastructure and so on. If you persist with the Victorian pattern of terracing, you're going to have issues with light and pollution and with access and infrastructure and transport. You're going to have the same kind of problem that you have with old-fashioned Victorian cities. So hence the thinking behind building these high-rise blocks, which would be done extensively in council housing. Right, well, we move very quickly. The first council estate that the Tecton practice built was a spar green estate in Finsbury, which they finished in, they started it in 1946 and they finished it in 1950. Three blocks, two slab blocks, quite high rise, and then one curved middle rise block, set in landscapes, next to Sadler's Wells along Rosebery Avenue. So it's a very central London location now, and indeed quite a fashionable location nowadays. It wasn't when they first built it. But this is really a very high standard piece of building. The Lubetkin's been able to persuade Finsbury Council and get the government to fund elaborately built and well-constructed and well-designed flats. And this is the front of one of the main buildings. Each flat has got its own private balcony. The facings are in brick and tile, so they're friendly and they're not going to corrode badly. But there are things like parabolic entrance archways over the entrance. The back of the building, all the bedrooms face away from the road into the interior of the estate. It's a bit sort of bleak, perhaps, but he's introduced this idea of ventilation patterns in the side of the building based on carpet designs. He was very keen on Persian carpet design, and he introduced this sort of checker pattern into the face of the building to try and make it more interesting. And the sinuous block is, again, quite visually interesting. The interior is sacrificed for that visual exterior. But then again, you can see the facing. It's all in tile and brick. There's no exposed concrete in Lubetkin buildings. But by the time this estate was built, the Tecton practice had collapsed. It had fallen apart for a variety of reasons. And Lubetkin was now a part-time architect. He started a new practice, Skinner Bailey and Lubetkin. And Skinner Bailey and Lubetkin then built housing estates out in the East End. And this is the first of the ones they finished some of the ones in Finsbury. This is Priory Green. They had to save a lot of money. It was not as beautifully built as it should have been. The flats were not so well designed. The facings were rather inferior. He then built something called Bevan Court. Interestingly, it was going to be Lenin Court originally, but communism went out of fashion in the 1950s. It became Bevan Court. And again, he had to compromise. There were no private balconies to speak of. The access to the flats was through public galleries, as it usually was in tenement blocks in the 1930s. So he had to go downhill quite a lot trying to get this thing built for the money he wanted to spend on it. It has a very dramatic feature, which is this sort of Piranesian central well from which all the staircases empty out. This is a trick that a lot of modernists used to sort of counter the austerity. They would put something really elaborate and beautiful, in this case, the stairwell inside the building to make it look dramatic. This has been repainted in the early 2000s in the original paint scheme, which Lubetkin had wanted for it. And then the practice went on building further out into Berthold Green. This is the Dorset estate. Again, it's a Y-shaped building, a bit like Bevan Court. Very big, very dramatic. Then further out is the giant Cranbrook estate. We've only shown the entrance here, very, again, a friendly, homely kind of entrance to the estate with these giant blocks in the background with originally carefully landscaped gardening around them. And they're very light and airy places, which is what the modernists wanted to do. And then this is Civil House, which is also in Bethnal Green, in now Tower Hamlets. It's actually near Columbia Road Street Market, and it's built on the site of an old piece of social building from the 19th century, which had demolished. And this is Civil House. And as you can see, the facing is now essentially postmodern. This is hardly the pure milk of modernism. He's made the building facing incredibly decorated. And this was put up in the late 1960s. So he's become a postmodernist in terms of his facing. And at the back of the building, there's a semicircular staircase going all the way up. And again, even the back of the building is quite nicely designed and laid out. But through a whole of this period, through the 1950s and 60s, what is Goldfinger doing? The answer is not very much. Goldfinger's practice is just not doing terribly well. He builds a few schools. This is an example of a school in Hammersmith, which is now listed. He built a tower for the school outside. He did a certain amount of domestic building. This is an infill site in Regent's Park, which is quite famous. It's a block of 10 flats put into a very small site. The flats are crammed in, but inside the flats look much bigger than they actually are. It's one of Goldfinger's talents was to take a small space and sort of grow it a bit like a kind of TARDIS. The inside looks bigger and feels bigger than the outside. But he doesn't worry about raw concrete in the sense that he's prepared to expose it, but he will try and dress it a bit. He wants it hammered. We won't just have plain raw concrete. It's too ugly. And he's got a lot of brickwork in there, again, to make a more friendly and welcoming kind of building. He then moves into office buildings, begins to have some big commissions, office blocks, of which the most famous is Alexander Fleming House in the Elephant Castle, which started out as the Ministry of Health's offices. Then they abandoned it in the 1980s, 90s. It was then repurposed as a residential block. It's now Metropolitan Heights, and it's now a block of flats. And so in a sense, Lubetkin, Goldfinger, although he wanted to start out building houses, he was forced to build offices, but this in the end has been turned into a block of flats. So this is now housing. But the things that he's most well famous for, of course, the great blocks, Belfront Tower and Trellick Tower. And this is actually not Belfront Tower, this is Carradale House, which is a middle-ranking or middle-sized block just by Belfront Tower. And I photographed it this way to show that the drama of the way these Goldfinger blocks can look dramatic as they're lit and shaded in a rather beautiful way. They're hulking, but their hulkingness is somehow mollified by the patterns that are created as you look through parts of the building. The separate lift blocks, which are characteristic of Belfront and Trellick Tower, these separate lift blocks, the reason for that is that if you were building in the 1960s, you couldn't stop lifts from vibrating, and therefore the vibrations from the lift shaft would spread through the building. But if you put a separate lift shaft, of course, you've solved that problem. So that's the reason why Trellick and Belfront have these separate fortress-like towers. It's for the lifts to go up and down and for some of the big service elements to be put in. There are walkways across to the residential properties. The walkways are only every third floor, which means you don't have to stop the lift too often. The lifts only stop 9 times rather than 36 times. And then you walk across the walkways, and then the flats themselves, you walk into the third floor flats from the corridors. So it's quite a way of separating out the mechanics of the building away from the domestic spaces. Right, I've overstepped my time by quite a long way. I'll do one last thing. We're saying that Ronan Point collapse really was the end of all this public building in concrete. The other thing was, of course, a reaction against modernism, the rediscovery of the charms of historical buildings and Victoriana. And those of us who first built our houses in the 1960s were guilty of this. People who had old-fashioned houses spent a lot of time modifying the interior to make them look modern. They would put hardboard over the fireplaces, and they put hardboard on the doors to get rid of the panelling. And we young historicists would move in and rip all this stuff out straight away in order to show the historic structure behind. So this is the beginning of this movement against modernism, bitumen and all that stuff too. And where I live now in Bath was a kind of epicentre of this reaction against modernism. And Bath was famous for fighting hard against what people at the time regard as the desecration. This is a street in Bath in which the left-hand side looking up is all old terracing, late Georgian Regency-style terracing, fairly artisan-type terracing. It's for sort of reasonably poor people. And then the other side, we've got these modernist blocks built in sort of reflecting on the Georgian buildings that they're among, but not perhaps reflecting on them terribly well. They're faced in Bath stone, but they have a modernist feel about them. They're hulking, and they were regarded as excrescences compared to the glories of Bath itself. Now, sort of 30, 40 years later, those of us who live here don't kind of quite notice this huge discrepancy, which the people at the time did. But Bath has come to live with the modernism that was put up in the 1960s and early 70s. It hasn't put any more up, I have to say. And when it did try to put things up, it gets fought against. But Bath was an example of the fight against it, one of the reasons why modern disappeared. I've said quite enough, so I'll finish now.
Thank you very much, Nick. Really interesting and engaging. Would you like to just stop screen sharing and let's... we've got a huge amount of time, but let's look at the chat.
Okay, I'll stop share. Yes, has that taken it out?
Good. Yes, that's absolutely fine.
Anna,
I don't know whether you want to take over at this point or whether you'd like me to just scan the
No, I would
conversation.
just, I've noticed we've got some comments in the chat box, but I wonder if anybody had any questions. They're welcome now that they, you know, we can see you all. If you want to just put your hand up and ask Nick anything while he's here. Otherwise, I will leap in.
No, if you prefer to type.
Some silence.
No, I'll just, while anybody's typing, Nick, I'd like to ask, I mean, it's a very wide question, unfair really, but do you have any theories on why the Brits were so averse to modernism? There really are very few modernist buildings in Britain, aren't there? You know, compared to in Germany and Austria and so on.
I don't know the answer. I guess it's some socioeconomic cultural thing. I mean, I guess if we look at the big European cities, Berlin, Paris, Vienna, Barcelona, from the very beginning, they've always been tenement blocks, as indeed they are in Glasgow. It's built on a tenement principle. But British cities just didn't seem to be built that way. Birmingham and London never had particularly high rise, and they just spread out. The suburb, and Britain is notorious for its suburbs, low rise terraces, shooting out across the arterial roads in the 1930s, ribbon development.
Yes.
Why,
yeah
that sort of
because of the ideal maybe of having, as you say, a little house with a little garden rather than living in a flat.
It's the garden that's the key, I think. If you go back to the sort of artisan terracing, trusted round mine shafts and, you know, round industrial developments that happened, the thing that the people were offered were gardens. That's the one thing they had, was gardens of their own. And of course, if they're up in the middle of the north, these big cities are located in glorious countryside roundabout. So maybe poor British have always been more in tune with nature than the poor Europeans have. Never been particularly, I mean, Gibbard, a modernist building in the 1950s, said, you know, the Britons love suburbs, he said, that's what they like to live in. And he couldn't understand why these modernists wouldn't have them.
Yeah.
Perhaps the British like to live.
Could I just flip the coin there slightly? I mean, obviously the general point holds true, but equally there were a significant number of interesting modernists at work in Britain, both homegrown and immigrants. So for example, I'm wondering what the connection was, if any, with Isochon and with Wells Coates and that project. And on the back of that, you talked rather cryptically and mysteriously about the sort of, I think you used the word tortured, you know, sort of inner lives, if you like, of the two protagonists. And I just wondered, I mean, I'm thinking also, am I right, London Zoo's Julian Huxley connection? The whole left-wing Hampstead-based circles in which both of them, I assume, Hampstead and Highgate, mixed, and the level of refugee aid, you know, sort of activities. Valeria, who I see is in the audience, has done a lot of interesting research on Gordon Samuel, who of course was a member of Tecton and very active in the Architects Refugee Committee. I just wondered if you might like to sort of just pad out perhaps that, you know, sort of refugee and immigrant sort of modernist circle in which they moved.
Well, certainly for both Goldfinger and Lubetkin, their early commissions were all because they had left-wing connections. As you said, in Zoo, it was not Get Huxley, it was the one before. It was Gwyn Vevers. No, not Gwyn Vevers. He was the curator. Senior moment, the name escapes me, but it was a left-wing cabal, if you like, in charge of London Zoo, and that's why Tecton were given that that job. Goldfinger, indeed, in the 1940s, unable to find any work, the only work he could find was reconstructing trade union headquarters and rebuilding the daily worker building. So again, it was these left-wing connections that got him to work. And then he moved into he was interested in education, which is why he was able to make some success with the education, the LCC education program, building schools. But yeah, there's for both of them, they're homing in on left-wingers in England who are going to be their friends and mentors. I mean, Lubetkin was, I think, deceived. He met all these left-wing people and thought that there was going to be, if not a communist revolution, and certainly a socialist revolution. You know, he felt that, you know, the British would soon come on board with this left-wing, and was, I think, deeply upset when that didn't happen. He was, as I said, Bevan House was originally going to be called Lenin House. He had to change that name because communism went, Russian communism went rapidly downhill in British thinking in the 1950s. Although during the war, we'd been, you know, hand in glove with the Russians in our attacks on Germany.
Well, and there's also the very specific aspect, isn't there, that Goldfinger was responsible for an exhibition that was actually held at Two Willow Road. Yes. Artists Aid Russia, was that the title? It was. And which was also, there was a kind of sister project of the Wallace Collection of all places. So there's more to it than meets the eye. And obviously there isn't time to go into detail. Sure. I'm just looking at some of the questions and comments coming in. Ruth Baumberg asking, yes, a very practical question. Were there stairs in the main non-lift apartment building? I'm not sure, Ruth, which particular
building. The ones with those lift towers, did they have stairs in the main part? Because otherwise it would be a fire hazard if there were only stairs in the lift bit.
Yeah, good question, to which I ought to know the answer and don't, but I'm pretty certain there had to be some kind of alternative stairwell down. Yes. I'm afraid I don't know the detail. I apologise for that.
Yes, but a very good practical question. Now, somebody I'm not quite sure who it is. It's Yoga Smart Tab, an intriguing designation there. But yes, a good point, just a point of fact, but obviously relevant. When the Goldfingers moved to London, they actually lived in High Point.
They did indeed, yes.
So
another reason why Goldfinger didn't like him.
Okay, all right.
He made a whole series of errors in Goldfinger's view, and he wasn't going to make the same errors himself.
And the same person commenting that actually Ronan Point was jerry built, whereas Ernö actually built properly. I don't know whether you'd sort of back up that view.
Absolutely. I mean, he was, Ronan Point actually collapsed. I don't know whether you know this, but Ernö and Ursula went to live in Belfont Tower for 2 months in order to find out from the people who lived in it whether this calumny that they hated living there was true. And they interviewed the occupants extensively and found that they didn't hate it. They actually quite liked it. And this gave Goldfinger the belief that he wasn't, you know, it wasn't wrong to build these sound blocks. It was wrong to blame him for doing it. And the very day after he left, Ronan Point collapsed. And he did have a few, I think, troubled nights, wondering whether, in fact, he was wrong. But he, once he took to Ovarup and gone through the structural issues properly, then yes, there was no problem. Goldfinger's buildings, Lubetkin's buildings, are not going to fall now. They're not jerry-built, they're extremely well-built. But yes, Larsen prefabricated system is not a good system.
I can't resist just mentioning one thing, and I'll turn to Anne Rao in a minute, because she has personal reminiscences, which I think will be of interest to people. I'm putting in mind, when you were talking about the Finsbury Health Centre, there's that wonderful Abraham Games wartime poster. It's part of that series, what is it, Britain, Your Britain, Fight for It Now, which actually shows this kind of derelict, you know, sort of site behind the facade of this spanking new building, which is clearly inspired by Finsbury Park. So it's much, it's part, isn't it, as you quite rightly said, of a much bigger utopian project, which is easily, I think, forgotten these days, indeed. Anne, I don't know whether you'd like to just unmute yourself and give us your sort of, fairly briefly, for reasons of time, your sort of reminiscences about actually living at High Point. Are you there?
I think she's gone, Monica.
Yes, no, Anne is there. Do you want to unmute yourself, Anne? I don't think I can do it.
She doesn't hear very well. I perhaps she's
the. Oh yes, ask to unmute.
Yes.
Okay. That's it. There we go.
Okay. Yes, I'm unmuted. Right. What do you want to know?
Well, just pad out what you've written rather cryptically in the chat. You know, obviously you have first-hand reminiscences with Roy's.
I was brought up in High Point. My oldest brother was a baby when the family moved there. I'm post-war. He was pre-war, of course. My father was a doctor and had lots of interesting patients who came in. I remember Lubetkin. I must add that my mother's maiden name was Gestetner. So we got to High Point. They got to High Point. I'm too young. They got to High Point because it was the flats for the Gestetner factory that was in Tottenham. I remember a lot of criticism about the concrete because it was thought that the concrete wouldn't last more than a very short space of time. And of course, nowadays we can all drive past High Point and there it is still standing. There was a huge difference between High Point 1 and High Point 2. High Point 1, with the exception of our flat, were all on one floor. And there were some one-bedroom flats that I understand were built for the staff. High Point 2 flats are all duplex, and if you visualize High Point, the ones on the side were smaller than the grand ones in the middle. And I'll answer any other questions that people might have.
Thank you, Anne. Anna, I'm conscious of time. I think you had some questions, didn't you, want to put to Nick?
Well, no, I asked poor Nick an impossible question about why we didn't have modernism in Britain.
That was a big one.
And the other question really, that he explained in the talk was how he didn't go, you know, he didn't want to go into the, you know, the terrible implications of the Holocaust for the two people. But, you know, I just emphasize it again. Everything is in here. It's the cultural contribution, the historical, the refugee aspect, and a very detailed account of the architecture and the social condition and political conditions in Britain as well. Even though it's very slim, but he gets it all in there. And I really do recommend it. It's a very readable book, and you can get it anywhere, Amazon, whatever.
For the context of insiders outsiders, that the Holocaust context is really crucial. I mean, both men were clearly not refugees in the conventional or orthodox sense of the word, and yet they were here. They couldn't have gone back. They wouldn't have wanted
exactly
to go back.
That's important.
They both
important.
Lost close
yeah.
family in the Holocaust, and that I think cuts very close to the bone, doesn't it?
Yes, very much so. You didn't have time in your talk, Nick, to go over that, but you know, the shadow of the Holocaust fell over them very, very darkly, especially I think perhaps Lubetkin. Mm-hmm. And it's actually fascinating what you've written there. And again, it's all in the book.
I must say that the shadow of the Holocaust did not exist in High Point.
No, but on Lubetkin, you're reading the book on Lubetkin's personal family story.
Yes. Yeah. I need to read the book. You're right, Anne.
You do. Yes, I'll lend you my copy, Anne.
And of course, one thing we haven't mentioned, which I imagine most of the people in the audience are well aware of, is that Two Willow Road is a National Trust property these days, is open to the public at slightly idiosyncratic times. But if you haven't been, wonderful place, full of fascinating details and indeed artworks as well as architectural interest. Last chance, everybody. I think probably rumbling stomachs beckon increasingly, but if anybody else would like to add or ask something, now is the moment.
Perhaps just to add then, Monica, that the people who didn't make it can, or people who watch tonight can recommend that the other people can see it on their YouTube channel, the Insider Outsiders YouTube channel. It'll be uploaded in a few days, perhaps?
In a few days' time, yes, indeed. And there are, you know, as I've mentioned, Insiders Outsiders straddles many different art forms and individuals as well as, you know, themes. But yes, if you're not familiar with the YouTube channel, take a look. There's plenty on architecture, but plenty on other things besides.
Can I just say one last thing?
Yes, of course.
Hands on screen. Now, we have spoken because you came along to the version of this I gave at Imperial before I wrote the book. And I did incorporate, in my first draft of the book, quite a lot of the interesting things that you said about living in High Point, but I'm afraid because it's a very slim volume, most of that is gone. I deeply regret that. I didn't have enough time to talk about actually living there. And interestingly, one of the people who's going to come along to the talk tonight, but probably can't see it live, but will see it on recording, is a person who actually lived in number 3 Willow Road during the Goldfinger era. So he lived next door to them. In the whole of the post-war period, and I should be very interested to have a chat with him about what it's like living next to Goldfinger. I'm not sure the National Trust knows about it. I wish they would know about him. And I have to say, the National Trust's treatment of Willow Road, I haven't been there recently, but I understand the idea, the opening hours, not just idiosyncratic, they're positively difficult to get to grips with. It used not to be like that sort of 5-7 years ago. It was much more, much better, but it's not good, which is a pity.
It's a shame, though, but actually, for those of you who aren't in Northwest London, to combine it with a visit to the Isocon building at the weekend,
yes,
absolutely to be recommended. And it really, both of them, they concentrate, among, you know, among many other things, on really demonstrating how rich a cultural terrain Hampstead was. I mean, really quite extraordinary. One of my favourite sort of topics to go on about, which I don't propose to do, but really worth pursuing. All right, I think we probably better call it a day. Thank you so much, Nick, above
yes,
all.
Yes, thank you, Nick.
You too. Thank you, everybody, for attending. And just a reminder that next week, next Monday already, the 12th of February, we have a talk on, actually, even less.
Monday's the 11th, actually,
figures.
Isn't
no,
it?
No, that's the 12th.
Monday's the 11th. Tuesday the 12th.
Yes, Monday the 12th, on Walter and Rita Nürnberg, who were German-born, mostly industrial photographers, who came to this country again in the 1930s, made it their home, and actually made a real mark in pioneering a sort of much more modernist approach to the renderings of industrial life in this country. So I do recommend that. And as I say, take a look. You can subscribe to the newsletter if you go to the Insiders Outsiders festival.org website. Go to the bottom right of any page, you can subscribe to the newsletter, and you'll be kept informed of subsequent events, because we have plenty up our sleeves for the coming months. Good. Once again, Nick, thanks ever so much. And thank you, everybody, for being with us tonight. And thank you, Anne, as well. All right.
Thank you. Thanks,
good
Nick.
Night, everyone. Good
thank
night.
You.
Thank you.
Did anybody else have trouble with it? The meeting just stopping? Because after about 40 minutes, I lost the meeting.
Oh, I don't see why. It's still been recording. There wasn't... really sorry about that. I think I had some problems with the internet, and maybe you did as well. But
you should be able to watch the recording.
I don't think fault. Yeah. So with a bit of luck, you'll check out the recording on the YouTube channel. Yes, my apologies for that.
All thank right. you.
Would okay. you God bless technology. All right. Thank you very much. Good night. Good night.